Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Paul Salem. I'm the Vice President for Policy and Research at the Middle East Institute, and I would like to welcome you all to this session today on Egypt's economy, addressing the challenges ahead. Obviously, we've all been following the events in Egypt with great interest and great concern. Usually the focus on fast-moving political developments from the revolution of January 2011 to what happened just a few days ago with the resignation of the cabinet and the formation of a new one. Certainly, much of what happened from January 2011 and 2012 and 13 and so on, much of it has to do with the economy, high unemployment rates, high poverty rates, marginalized communities, youth bulge, things of that nature, and hence sort of the economy has been behind a lot of the change and unrest that has been taking place in Egypt. In the months ahead, one expects a new presidency, a new government to be in place, sort of a new attempt at moving forward in Egypt, both politically and economically. And as happened in the previous presidency, much will depend on whether this new order can create the economic promise, the economic progress that is much demanded and urgently needed by the population. The economic indicators in the past 3 years, as happens in all transitions, obviously are difficult, are worrisome, slow GDP growth, rising unemployment, high inflation, growing budget deficits, growing public debts. So it certainly has been an increasingly challenging situation. On the other hand, there's been strong support from outside, particularly from different Gulf countries at different times. We have with us today a very distinguished panel of experts and people also who are very much involved in Egypt, in the international financial institutions, and in some of the U.S. business communities, in thinking about understanding the challenges of Egypt's economy and being part of trying to move it forward. We have, as I said, four distinguished individuals. From Cairo, a friend and colleague, Dr. Ahmed Ghoneim, immediately to my left. Dr. Ghoneim just flew in from Cairo a couple of days ago. He is a professor of economics in the Faculty of Economics and Political Science at Cairo University. He's been a research fellow at the Economic Research Forum for the Arab countries, which is based in Egypt. He's been there for many years. He's done a lot of seminal work on the Egyptian economy as well as other economies in the region, has been an advisor to government in Egypt during many phases. His presentation will be followed by a presentation by Dr. Shantayanan Devarajan. Dr. Devarajan is the chief economist of the World Bank Middle East and North Africa region. He had previously been the principal economist and research manager at the Development Research Group. He was director of the World Development Report in 2004, taught previously at Harvard and other places. Very pleased to have him with us here to give us the views of himself, the World Bank, and very important research and studies that they've been doing there. His presentation will be followed by the presentation of Dr. Zubair Iqbal. Dr. Zubair is an adjunct scholar at the Middle East Institute, but he had a long and distinguished career at the International Monetary Fund, where he was the assistant director for the Middle East and Central Asia Department. And he has just completed, and I think it's available, a paper on the economic challenges in Arab transition countries, obviously including Egypt, but also covering Tunisia as well. The presentation of our fourth panelist will be by Mr. Steve Lutes. Steve is the Director of Middle East Affairs at the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, and he's the Executive Director of the U.S.-Egyptian Business Council, as well as being involved in U.S.-Iraq business relations and business relations in the Gulf. Steve also works closely with many, many major companies that are in Egypt, interested in Egypt, visiting Egypt soon, so he can certainly give us a very interesting perspective of how the U.S. private sector and other global private sectors look at the opportunities and challenges in Egypt. So without further ado, let me turn the podium over to my friend Dr. Ghoneim.
Ahmed, faddal.
Thank you, Paul. It's a great pleasure to be among you here, and thank you for the invitation. Now, Paul asked me to give an overview of the Egyptian economy at the beginning, and probably the political economy perspective, which is more of interest to most of the people here, will come in the interventions. The Egyptian economy, as he said at the beginning, has been stumbling since the 25th of Jan revolution, and mainly most of the economic indicators have been deteriorating. But this is not the end of the story, because I see it a little bit different, in the sense of it could have deteriorated more in such an economy which is facing a lot of political upheavals and a lot of uncertainty. And in that sense, I see some kind of relief, at least not optimism, but at least relief from what's going on. I'll give you some indicators, and we see how can this be explained. The growth rate has been in the neighborhood of 2%, and that's extremely worrying for an Egyptian an economy like Egypt, which has reached more than 7% before the revolution and has not been heavily affected by the financial crisis of 2008. And what is more worrisome at this stage is that the population growth rate has surpassed the growth rate of the economy. The population growth rate has reached 2.5%, which means that by all means the real GDP per capita has been declining heavily over the last 2 years. Adding to that, that the poverty rate has increased by 5%. The announced poverty rate of the Egyptian authorities was 20% before the revolution, and now they are 25%. And here we're talking about the people below the $1.25 per day. If we take it by the $2 threshold, then we reach around 45% of the population below the poverty rate. This is extremely worrisome, because this is an indication of increasing crime rate, increasing political instability, and inability of the government to undertake any kind of economic reform in the near future. The other thing is the fiscal indicators. The fiscal indicators are again getting extremely worrisome. Now we're talking about a budget deficit that's in the neighborhood of 13%, and there is extremely very small maneuvering for this government or the coming government or any in the forthcoming future governments that can reduce such budget deficit heavily. And this we have seen one of the reasons that might explain why there was a resignation of the cabinet 2 days ago, simply because there was manipulation of the minimum wage, which a lot of the segments of the population did not accept, and hence they went down to the streets again. And I believe that's the most difficult job for any coming president and cabinet in the coming few years, how to address the challenge of the widening budget deficit and the increasing public debt. The public debt has reached high levels that Egypt never reached before. We're talking about something in the neighborhood of 240 billion public domestic debt and around 47 billion US dollars in terms of external debt. That all in all add to around 110 of the GDP, which is by international levels is some way acceptable, but all depends on the prospects of this economy. So, and what's more worrisome in the Egyptian case is not the, the overall level, but rather the domestic public debt. And now what we've seen right now is that there is, and that's worrying for me, is that the monetary policy is becoming not to be independent as before. A month ago, the Central Bank of Egypt decided to lower the overnight deposits rates, and it loosened the monetary policy, signaling, as they said, the issue of adoption of expansionary monetary policy to enhance investment. But definitely that was not the case, because they wanted to reduce the debt burden of the government, especially that it has been increasing tremendously. And the issue is that the market responded at the moment, and the inflation rate started to increase. Now we're talking about inflation rate that reached almost 13%, which is still under control. But again, for me, that's worrying, because it shows that the monetary policy is not anymore targeting an inflation rate, and that there is some kind of wrong coordination, I would say so, deviation from the main role of the Central Bank of Egypt. On the other hand, the exchange rate, that is one of the issues that I would see a success for the Central Bank. And why is that? Because if I look at what happened to the exchange rate after the 25th of January revolution, you would easily see that it only devalued by 20%. It was $1 equals to around 6 Egyptian pounds, and it now increased to $1. The official is $1.6.99 Egyptian pounds, which is not very bad. There is a black market premium, but it's still in the range of 30 piastres. That is almost less than around 5%. In that sense, it is I consider it a success, because in any other situation, anybody would expect an overshooting of the Egyptian the dollar to reach higher levels than that. And this is mainly because of the help of the Gulf countries, whether we're talking about Qatar during the Muslim Brotherhood era, or we're talking about the generous, extremely generous money flowing in Egypt from the Gulf after the outset of Morsi. And here we're talking about numbers in the range of, actually they were 17 billion US or 18 billion US dollars. Out of them, there is around 7 billion in form of grants. So this is definitely helping the Egyptian economy to survive. And although they are adding to the debt, some of it is adding to the debt burden, but a political economy aspect, I would say that this is definitely relieving Egypt and the current regime from the economic hardships of the lack of foreign exchange, and enabling it to maintain some kind of standard of living that would have worsened further if such assistance was not there. What remains worrisome, and I showed Paul some kind of progress the government has signaled, is the issue of subsidies. And the subsidies, mainly we're talking about energy subsidies, have been started to be a big headache, and have been already signaled in all the media that it needs reform. But still, no cabinet was able to reform it. The signal that actually came to place and was tangible was issuing some kind of smart cards. And those smart cards are set to ensure that every car owner would use it. And this, as announced by the cabinet, will enable the government's to check on the smuggling of the diesel and the gasoline. But still, that's not the end of the story, because I believe they will be used as ration card at a further stage. But this is not in the near future. And the subsidies are a big issue, because they represent around one-third of the government expenditure. And If we take one third going to subsidies, and mainly they are energy subsidies, more than 80% of the subsidies are going to energy, only 14% is going to food, and if we take around 25% going to pay debt and arrears and interest rates, and if we take around 27% going to wages, then you can imagine that what's remaining from the government expenditure is less than 20% for undertaking investments. Now, with the new constitution saying that 10% has to be devoted of the GDP, has to be devoted to health and education, I was not very sure of this is whether it's a good thing or not. But what I believe it is going to do is that it's going to increase the level of untransparency, lack of transparency, and manipulation of the governments to adhere to this 10% of the GDP. Now, what remains worrisome is the unemployment, as Paul said at the beginning. But again, the unemployment is a very complex issue, which might we can talk about it in the intervention, but let me highlight here one of the issues. The state of chaos that we're living in Egypt is related to unemployment, and simply the lack or the intention of the government to let the informal sector proliferate is actually a way of letting overcoming the inability of the government to deal with unemployment. So if you come to Egypt if you have already came to Egypt in the last year, you would easily see that there is lack of rule of law on the streets. There is a lot of informal sector everywhere, and that is mainly, I believe, is the intention of the government to leave it this way because it cannot deal with unemployment. The other thing is that the unemployment, we have always talked about it in Egypt as if it's a supply side issue, whereas in fact there is new literature evolving talking about it as a demand side issue, and here it is related to the issue of subsidies and mainly energy subsidies. And the issue here is because of the energy subsidies, a lot of investments is not going into the labor intensive, because it's much more profitable to go in the energy intensive industries and not the labor intensive. The end result is that no labor intensive investments are taking place in Egypt. So that's an overview of what's happening in Egypt, and maybe the political insights will come further, and I think I'm adhering to the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ghoneim. Thank you. A very sobering picture, definitely, but certainly gives us a lot of the basic analysis and information to begin this panel and then later the discussion. Let me turn to Mr. Devarajan, please.
Okay, thanks very much for this opportunity, and I have to say that I prepared some remarks that are very complimentary to what Ahmed just gave you. But let me step back a minute and start with a puzzle, at least it's for me because I'm relatively new to this region, which is that if you look at the indicators, not just growth, as Ahmed mentioned earlier, but even inequality in Egypt before the revolution, they were pretty good. The Egypt's Gini coefficient, which is what we use to measure inequality, was lower than the average for middle-income countries and was actually declining before 2011. And yet there was a revolution. And so we really have to understand what was going on, what was the cause of it, because our basic economic indicators don't give us the answer. And I think it's, as both Paul and Ahmed said, certainly there's unemployment. But I think it is what Ahmed was saying earlier. It's not just the official unemployment of the educated youth, although that's an important part of it. It's this large informal sector. 75% of the labor force is either self-employed or in the informal sector in Egypt. So when we're talking about unemployment, we're only talking about the other 25% that has an unemployment problem. But the huge problem is that most Egyptians, three-quarters of the Egyptian workforce, is working in very low productivity jobs, but mainly because they don't have the choice. They don't have the opportunity to be unemployed. They have to earn a living. So that's the problem that that we're facing. The other things that haven't been mentioned is, if you look, the quality of public services was really appalling. Egypt has done tremendously well in terms of access to education, access to health care, but very, very badly on the quality of that. You have problems with teacher absenteeism, and we know the evidence, because the children, even though they go to school, don't seem to do very well on these internationally comparable tests. So they don't seem to be learning very much. But also on the health side, we've actually done the surveys. About 20% of the time the doctors are absent from the public health clinics. And the reason is because they're working moonlighting in the private sector, even though people are supposed to get free health care in the public sector. In fact, as one woman put it, you have a choice. You can either go to the private sector and lose all your money, or go to the public sector and lose your life. Right. And then finally, and I think this is the point about the lack of investment in labor-intensive industry, the entire manufacturing and industrial sector was captured. It was captured by elites. We've actually done, and some of you are talking about some of the work that the World Bank is doing. We're actually doing research on crony capitalism, where we actually tried to track the Mubarak firms and looked at their profitability relative to the rest. And you can find that the relative stock market prices of the Mubarak firms versus the others, that ratio fell below one on January 25th, 2011. It was consistently well above one beforehand. And these firms were actually capital intensive, energy intensive, as Ahmed said, because the fuel subsidies made it attractive for them. And in fact, they were many of these crony firms were the ones that were the most energy intensive in Egypt. So you see that the whole system of public policy was geared towards elite capture. And this is what people were demanding their share of. This is what they were denied. They were, the government took the view, well, these subsidies are for the poor. But in fact, the poor were lost out, not just in fact that most of the subsidies go to people who drive gas guzzlers and so on, but also because it actually denied them jobs. So this is the profound exclusion that was debilitating the society. Now, as many people have said, after 2011, we're also facing a macroeconomic collapse. Growth has collapsed, as Ahmed said, to about 2%, and the deficits have ballooned, fiscal deficit, and investment has come crashing down. And all of these other problems have gotten worse. Unemployment has gotten worse. The quality of public services has deteriorated. And the policies that have been enacted, mostly to address the political unrest, have actually made the problem worse. So the most recent one is the increase in the minimum wage in the public sector. Now think about that, right? We already said 75% of the population is in the informal sector, and you've got a fiscal deficit of 13% of GDP, and you increase the wages of the public increase the minimum wage in the public sector. In fact, we did the calculation that the people earning the new wage of 1,200 pounds, Egyptian pounds per month, the new minimum wage, those people are wealthier than 64% of the Egyptian population. Right? This is not the poor who are actually benefiting from the minimum wage increase. So I think this discussion about how, and you know that the political unrest over the last couple of weeks is the people in the private sector demanding that they get a minimum wage increase as well. So, you know, again, completely missing the point that the informal sector is actually going to suffer as a result of this minimum wage. So what are we supposed to do here? We have to. This is, if you like, there are twin crises here. There's the original crisis of exclusion that hasn't gone away, and in fact may have gotten worse. And you've got a macroeconomic crisis at the same time. And how do you square this circle? How do you reconcile these two? It's a very serious situation. Well, I think we have to try to be pragmatic here. I mean, on the macro side, I think any effort to use them, and including the money coming from the Gulf, has to be used, and all these fiscal stimuli that they keep announcing, although they don't seem to do anything to the growth rate, all have to be geared towards restoring macroeconomic stability. So we have to keep in mind that that deficit has to go down. There's no way we can afford the. Actually, I thought the debt to GDP ratio was 100%. Now he said it was 110%. So I'm even more worried than 20 minutes ago. And that's really, you know the sort of international threshold is something like 70% of GDP is the time at which you start getting worried. Now we're like considerably further above that. So I'm trying to think a couple of things. I mean, one is, as Ahmed actually mentioned, the ratio of domestic debt to foreign debt is very high. So I mean, Egypt actually has very little foreign debt and a lot of domestic debt. So if you could use the external resources to substitute domestic debt for foreign debt, you can actually bring down the deficit. Because one reason is that interest rates are very high domestically because of the government debt. And that's actually what's squeezing the private sector. I mean, a lot of the firms you talk to say they can't get credit because the banks are actually investing their money in government bonds, because those interest rates are much more attractive than lending to firms. So if we can just shift the mix without increasing the overall level of debt, shift the mix towards international debt, that might work. But the other thing that is really important is to make sure that this money that's coming from the Gulf is actually generating growth and employment. This is the hardest challenge. I think this is what we all need to work on. I mean, all of us, I need your help too, because the structural impediments that created the unemployment, the large informal sector, are also the same impediments that prevent an additional infusion of cash from actually generating more employment and growth. So we need to move away from sort of this idea of just throw some money at the problem and it'll go away, to say, what are we doing about relaxing those structural impediments? And I think there, we come back to this problem. I think we can do a lot if we can actually reform the fuel subsidies. Because as Ahmed said as well, and some of our work substantiates that, is that the fuel subsidies have shifted the production mix in favor of capital-intensive industries. So what are we doing now at the bank about that? And it's hard because, as he said, it's a political decision. None of these governments has been willing to undertake the reform. But, you know, and perhaps naively, and some of my colleagues at the bank, some of whom are here, think that I'm a little crazy about this, but I still believe that we can actually build political consensus around the reform of the fuel subsidies. I mean, the question is, if the poor are likely to be unaffected or even benefit from reform of fuel subsidies, because if you replace it with a cash transfer program that's targeted to the poor, you can actually make them better off. Why is it so politically difficult to reform fuel subsidies? Put another way, I have a feeling that when people tell you, oh, it's politically difficult to reform fuel subsidies, it's those rents of the people who are currently benefiting from the fuel subsidies that are making it difficult, not because the poor are going to rise up. So if we can actually get this information out there about who's benefiting from the fuel subsidies, what would happen if you were to shift reform the fuel subsidies to the poor, to the people who are actually being hurt by them right now, we might be able to build political support. Now, this requires quite a big shift for us as the World Bank, because, you know, our usual strategy is we do some very nice piece of analytical work and we disseminate it by going to some luxury hotel in Cairo and inviting people like Ahmed to discuss it with us, and they all say nice things, and then we say, oh, we've disseminated it. So I really think we have to get out there and get these messages out to the woman in the village in Upper Egypt. Because it's about her, right? It's about their lives that we're talking. And that requires all sorts of shifts in the way we do business. And we're even talking about putting in, you know, TV shows or soap operas about fuel subsidy reform that will actually sing to the public. In fact, we've been in touch with some Turkey. I guess most of these soap operas are done in Turkey, right? So we're discussing it with some of the Turkish screenwriters. So stay tuned to that. And then finally, I mean, you're probably wondering, I haven't talked about what financial support the World Bank is contemplating. And I mean, one thing we have to be honest, I mean, our money is a tiny, tiny fraction of what either Egypt needs or what Egypt is getting from the Gulf. So the question is, can we use our money to leverage some other resources for the country? And I think we can. But there again, I think we need to gear our work, just like we're gearing our knowledge work, in order to relax some of these constraints that have prevented the poor and the lower classes from benefiting from economic growth. That has to be the way we do it. So we're actually talking about projects that are geared towards Upper Egypt, which is the poor part of the country, which is caught in a bit of a poverty trap. And if we can use our limited resources, leverage resources from the Gulf and other partners, although I guess it's mostly the Gulf these days, to actually relax some of those constraints. Now, I guess this is, again, a shift, because when we have discussions with the government, they always say, yeah, but there are all these projects we want to do on an airport in Sharm el-Sheikh and things like that. And we have to be vigilant, though, because I think the way we can actually resolve these twin crises is to unlock some of these policy distortions that have stood in the way both of macroeconomic stability and of an inclusive Egyptian society. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Devarajan. Definitely very complimentary to what Dr. Ahmed was the analysis he provided. Thanks, much more depth, also an interesting perspectives, a lot to think about and to perhaps ask about in the Q&A session. Let me ask Dr. Zubair Iqbal to take the podium. Zubair.
Well, whatever I wanted to say has already been said. Now, let me tell you what I'm going to be looking at. I'm trying to see why the choices were made with respect to policies and what were their implications. Quite clearly, in 2011, like in other countries in the quote-unquote, what we call the Arab countries in transition, Egypt was encountered with two basic problems. There was a serious macroeconomic imbalance, which was shown in the ballooning fiscal deficit as well as external current account deficit and the loss in external reserves. At the same time, it was encountering a very serious issue, and that was that revolution had generated demand for improvement in the quality of life through primarily increase in populist measures. The intention was, where is our dividend? So basically, any government that came into power, initially Mubarak government and later on the military-supported government, they had two conflicting objectives in their front. One, you have to fix the macroeconomic condition, because without that, you won't be able to proceed any further. Inflation had accelerated, unemployment is higher, fiscal deficits were increasing, and in the process, you're not only losing your external reserves, but the exchange rate was becoming out of line in real effective terms, which meant countries losing its effectiveness, as well as the globally, there was so much of uncertainty that all capital inflows had ceased. In fact, capital outflows had started, and the government was facilitating it. On the other hand, there was demand, but where is our dividend? So the point was, how do we create more employment? How do we resolve the poverty problem? How do we generate growth? These are obviously conflicting objectives. What did they choose? They basically realized that they couldn't go the route of economic stabilization for fixing the macroeconomics, which was needed before you could do anything else. They rather moved towards improving, quote-unquote, the quality of life by doling out funds in the form of higher wages, increased subsidies, and so on and so forth. result of that was that the fiscal deficit worsened, balance of payments position worsened, loss of reserves reached to a level where the reserves were left to less than 2 months of imports by 2013, early 2013. Now, this was a prescription for disaster. The government was not in a position to switch policies. So then came the military, and the military-supported government. The military-supported government brought in its own resolve. The resolve was fix it. But how did you fix it? Because you do not have the instruments, or you do not wish to follow the instruments that are needed to fix it. What happened, therefore, was that the external debt increased, domestic debt increased, exchange rate went out of line, you reduced the interest rate, inflation picked up, which meant that the real effective exchange rate depreciated dramatically. At the same time, you had allowed private sector to take the capital out of the country, which basically meant, do whatever you feel like doing, we are not going to interfere. Now, what did it do? And why did it happen? Now, you see, formulation of a macroeconomic package of reform is very easy. Everybody knows what needs to be done. The question always is, how did you implement it? Do you have the capacity to implement it? Here was a country, Egypt, which did not have what we call the political consensus needed to develop a constituency for reform. And no attempt was made in order to create that constituency. The impact, the objective always was minimize the conflict, give people what they want, even at the expense of worsening the short-term problem, without any confidence that in the long term things will change. There were no stakeholders who were on board. The new government that came into power after 2013, in fact, had a more serious problem on its hands, because now it had magnified the conflict that existed in the society, which meant it was even more difficult to create what we call a confluence of stakeholders, which include the labor, which include the elites, which include the military, which include the private sector, the liberal groups, and so on and so forth, to be able to formulate a commonly agreed program that could be implemented. Therefore, what do we have at this moment on our hands? We have a situation, as Ahmed and my colleague from the World Bank has indicated, we have a situation where the economy isn't growing. Unemployment is going up. It's becoming increasingly difficult to contain subsidies. Wage increases have created their own dynamics. Private sector investment is not going to take place unless confidence is restored in the market that they will be sustained policies over a period of time and that they're right policies. What do you do under the circumstances? What needs to be done? There's no sense in going over the numbers once again, but let me just throw a couple of numbers at you. The initial estimate, my back of the envelope estimate of the financing gap for 2013 and 2014 fiscal year is about $25 billion needed to meet the external financing requirements and about $50 billion equivalent needed to meet the fiscal requirements. That's massive. If all of that were to go into the picture, the debt will go to about 130% of GDP, which is horrendous, which is not sustainable. 50% of the budget will have to be paid to finance the debt itself. It's just not feasible. What do you do under these circumstances? You have to formulate a program. It doesn't have to be a fund program. A domestic program is fine. A program should aim at putting into effect measures which will, over a period of time, perhaps 3 years, reduce the fiscal deficit to manageable levels from 13 to 14% right now down to 6, 7% in 3 years' time. Annual programs that will get you there. That will require not only a reduction in subsidies, as you very ably said, quite correctly so, but also a rebalancing of expenditures. I mean, Tunisia has done it under very great difficulties. It can be done. There has to be a movement away from consumption to investment in the government spending activities. There has to be reduction in some expenditures to be able to generate that fiscal space that you need to generate investment. Because it's only then that private sector will come into the picture, and not through the gimmick of reducing the interest rate. All that does is accelerates inflationary pressures and worsens the exchange rate. With that, you must introduce tax measures which will not only improve the equity in the society, but also generate revenue. But that can be done only if you're transparent, very explicit of why you're doing it and what are you going to do with this. Egypt has been talking about a VAT for the last 25 years. Its sales tax is something which has the ability to go to VAT. It must move there, and very quickly. It can be done, it should be done. Similarly, bring into the system the informal sector so that tax revenue can go up. Then we come to the picture, what do we do with the external financing? Look, the GCC financing has been like giving more, basically creating more problems for Egypt than solving them. Because what that financing has done is to raise the level of expenditure to a level which is financeable with this external financing. What will happen when the external financing isn't there? You cannot reduce that expenditure. There is downward stickiness in Egypt's expenditure. What do you do under those circumstances? So if you are going to depend upon external financing, that has to be linked to some very well-defined macroeconomic framework which will allow you to use it effectively, have the confidence of the lenders to you, and then be able to repay over time. My back of the envelope calculation is the following. You have a $25 billion external financing gap. Even if you were to have a program with the IMF, if you have a program, that will give you about $5 billion on the outer side, outer limit for 1 year. Perhaps less. Perhaps it will be less than that because it will be stretched over a period of 2 to 3 years. Then some money will come from the World Bank. Supposing some money comes from the Gulf. The point is, you cannot see $12 to $15 billion coming from the Gulf every year. Number one. Number two, not for unconditional purposes. So you have a financing gap of something like $10 billion. Which means your adjustment must be equivalent to what is needed to fill this gap. Otherwise, you're going to raise domestic debt, which is going to be horrendously dangerous. In other words, you are looking at a residual adjustment requirement of about $10 billion a year for the next 3 years. Is Egypt in a position to do it right now? What will Egypt have to do to be able to do that? From my point of view, the experience of East Asia, of Eastern Europe, some of the successful countries in Eastern Europe and Latin America shows you two very basic elements. One is, if you want to formulate a program, people must buy into it. In other words, you must be public on this. People must know why something is being done and what will be the consequence of that. And how soon they can get out of their present position problem into a much better future. Second, to be able to do that, you must have a constituency for reform. Do we have a constituency for reform in Egypt? Can we create that constituency for reform in Egypt? How do you do it? What steps did you take to get there? Third, are the stakeholders on board? Are the businessmen who are going to lose their subsidy on energy willing to buy into it? Are the informal sector, which is not paying any taxes right now, be willing to pay taxes because it's in their interest down the road to do it? In a situation where you're basically an open capital account and capital can move out of the country without difficulty, which means worsening of your exchange rate situation, your balance of problems. In other words, what I'm trying to emphasize is, we know the problem. It's very easy to understand. We know the conflict of objectives. We also know limited amount of policy instruments that we have at our hands. We also know the GCC largesse is not going to last for too long. What do we do under these circumstances? Isn't it justified under the circumstances to start creating that political consensus that will then help you to create the instrument of reform that you want to put into effect? I have no answer. Perhaps you do. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Iqbal, really digging deep into the difficult policy choices, making clear what needs to be done in a sense in theory and on paper, and how challenging it is to do politically, but how necessary as well. Thank you very much for that. Let's hear from Mr. Steve Lutes. Steve?
Thank you very much, Paul, and thank you very much to MEI for hosting this event on such an important topic. I'm honored to be here with these distinguished panelists. As mentioned, I'm from the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, which gives a little different vantage point. My comments will kind of be reflective of the U.S. companies that we work with, who are doing business in, and who are currently invested in Egypt. And for this audience, maybe a little context would be helpful. The U.S. Chamber, of course, we're well known for the work we do domestically with Capitol Hill, the administration, but actually our largest department is our international division. And within that international division, we have a Middle East team, and within that we have our U.S.-Egypt Business Council, which is essentially the home to the bilateral economic relationship and the leading advocacy organization to increase access and commercial engagement for U.S. companies in Egypt. The great thing about this council is that the interesting thing about it is that it's very cross-sectoral. We have companies in everything from agriculture and in education to consumer products to energy to healthcare, heavy manufacturing, automobiles, you name it. We essentially have companies on our council that represent that. So it's really a nice cross-section of the economy. Our mission essentially is to help strengthen that economic relationship, that commercial relationship between the United States and Egypt, and to help U.S. companies gain access and increase their investments and their trade activity in Egypt. One of the things that was mentioned, we are very interested in how we go about doing that. And there's essentially three spokes to the wheels, just to give you an idea of what we do. First and foremost, it's kind of policy formulation. And it's obviously with an eye to increasing commercial activity. And that is oftentimes it's how do we, what regulatory burdens can we remove? What policies could be put in place that would increase trade and investment? We also look at very basic things like business expansion. What type of activities can we do that will actually increase U.S. investment and trade again with Egypt? For example, in June, we'll be taking a business mission of probably at least 50 U.S. companies to Egypt to have meetings with key stakeholders in the private sector and in government. Earlier in April, we'll be doing some policy roundtables focused on healthcare and agriculture, again, talking about those obstacles to greater investment and greater commercial activity. And then, of course, for business people, it's basically it's how do we help them build their network? And with that, we're looking to increase formal and informal relationships with those key stakeholders who impact the commercial relationship. Back to the policy formulation and the issues, some of the things that we're working on, as I was kind of asked to speak about some of the challenges that we hear from U.S. companies, certainly protecting intellectual property rights or respect for patents, that's absolutely key for U.S. companies. Say in the healthcare sector, they need to know that if they're going to build a facility, do robust business there, that those are going to be upheld. So that's one thing that we're focused on. We're also talking again about the regulatory environment, which is this just kind of catch-all. But for example, in the auto industry, you know, there's a big discussion going on. Will Egypt follow EU standards or American standards? Really important topics, again, on whether you'll see increased U.S. investment. And one thing that we are hearing from the corporations that we're working with in fact, is that you haven't seen this mass exodus of U.S. companies who have been there many for decades, some over a century, in Egypt. In fact, we're hearing from many of the U.S. businesses that are already there that they're in fact increasing their investments in Egypt. And many are doing that with an eye to the long term. They frankly see a domestic market with over 90 million consumers. They see it as a regional hub. And just over again, over that long term, that it has incredible opportunity despite the challenges in turmoil that they're facing now. We also, I think an important factor is we convene a lot of meetings just like this here in Washington, D.C. and in Cairo with some of those government leaders and policymakers who can make change. And most recently, we hosted the Minister of Trade and Industry, Munir Noor, who now, from what I understand, is the minister of a combined ministry of trade and industry and investment. And he spoke to some of the specific investments that are being made by the government in some key projects in the Suez Canal, in the Golden Triangle. These are all things that I think you'll see U.S. companies looking to be a part of and invest in and make sure that they continue their presence there. With that, I think I'll turn it back to the panel. But I would just say, you know, from what we hear, again, from our U.S. corporate partners, is that there is very, very strong positive outlook, I guess you would say, for Egypt. And we also work closely, I should add, with our affiliate in Egypt. It's called the American Chamber of Commerce in Egypt, AmCham Egypt. They represent over 6,000 companies. It's a mix of both Egyptian companies and it also has representatives of U.S. companies who are based in Egypt. And we work very closely with them on the ground when we go there to do these type of things, these business missions and these roundtables. But thank you very much and appreciate thank the you, opportunity.
Thank you, Steve. And I'm going to turn it over for the audience, excellent audience we have here today. I'm going to ask a question first. In the meantime, you know, think about questions you would like to pose. We have a large and excellent audience, so we want as many opportunities for people to ask as they can. So please make your question short and only one question, and not a question with three parts and things of that nature. But so take a moment to think about that. But I want to throw a question to Dr. Ghoneim and Dr. Devarajan from what Dr. Iqbal said, the very important issue of building a constituency for reform. In a sense, perhaps it's known what needs to be done. It's very hard to do it politically. Neither the Morsi government nor the interim government. Now we will have a new presidency soon. It will have perhaps an opportunity to do something if it gets it right. And that might be, given the numbers, the last opportunity before even greater cataclysms occur. So let me ask Dr. Ahmed and Dr. Devarajan. Ahmed, what's your sense of the politics of trying to institute for reform? First of all, is there the outlines of such a vision that this is needed among people close to the new authorities? And if so, what might that constituency look like? And do you see it happening? Or will it just be, you know, living off the dole for a year or two until the whole thing really collapses? And from Dr. Devarajan, I'd like to gain from your experience, I mean, I'm sure you have something to say on Egypt about that as well, but from other countries, how did they manage in difficult circumstances to build such a constituency? But Ahmed, and from the table, that's fine. You need to.
Well, let me tell you, Paul, that I think Dr. Iqbal raised this is a very important issue. And I always said after the revolution that Egypt, to undertake the reforms, has two options, which one was mentioned by Dr. Iqbal, which is building the constituency, which is extremely difficult, and especially after the Ittihadiyya events in December 2012, it became very obvious. And so far till now, we were unable to do that. The second option, which is as well as difficult as the first, is to have another Saddam in Egypt to be able to do the reform. And both are difficult and not feasible. So far, I don't see this is possible at this stage with the political friction happening between the Muslim Brotherhood and the supporters of it and whoever is in power. But let me add another level of a problem which is not foreseen by most of the people, which is who takes the decision in Egypt. Now, after the revolution, it was very clear that we have two centers of taking decisions. It's the military on the one side and the government or whatever. Now, with this regime, we have three: the presidency, the military, as well as the government in place. But let me ask another layer, which is not foreseen by any of the people, which is the intelligence. Many of the decisions that can be undertaken by the cabinet, and I'm sure one of them is the ex-minister of finance, was the minimum wage is not suitable. And then comes this intelligence decision, forget about what you're saying, you have to do it. So there is invisible role played by an entity called the intelligence in Egypt, and it's becoming very important for the stability of the country, that's what say, and the national security, which definitely have a point, but it is overwhelming any kind of economic reform for the sake of the short-term political stability. And this, I don't know how it can be resolved. The only issue, the only way out I see that can it be resolved, although some people here, and especially since I'm in the West, will criticize me for that, is to consolidate the decision-making process, which means that Sisi, if he becomes a president, this means that the centers of decision-making in the country will be consolidated in one hand, including the intelligence, the military, blah, 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 blah. If it doesn't happen, then it will the fractions will be remaining, and we will have this power game that will never end. Thank you.
Yeah, actually, I think I come out around where Ahmed left off, because I actually think this phrase, building a constituency for reform, which I hear a lot, is actually misleading, because that's not how decisions get made. Right? Think about it. Right? We've had decisions, we have policies like the minimum wage in Egypt, which have been undertaken without a majority of the population benefiting from it. So clearly, it's not a sort of a normal process where you say, well, look at the policy change, look at what the median voter is going to choose, and then those are the ones that are going to pass. That's not how decisions get made in Egypt. By the way, that's not how decisions get made in most countries, including this one. All right. So let's ask the question another way. We are talking about reforms. I mean, the reforms that Zubair was talking about as well are reforms that are going to benefit the majority of the population. So you already have a constituency. That's not a problem. The real problem is it's also going to undermine the rents of some very powerful people. And so how do you influence them? How do you actually change those incentives for those very powerful people? So that these reforms will go through. It's not trying to build a constituency, and here there might be some possibility, because we've already seen very powerful people thrown out of office at least twice in the last 3 years, right? So it's not business as usual in Egypt at the moment. And then what we have to do, and this is my experience in other countries as well, is when the public is better informed, then the politicians begin to realize it's not business as usual. You can't go on taking away the rents from these people, from the poor people, because they're ignorant. They are suddenly better informed. That's why I was focusing on the information before. And just give you one anecdote or example. We did some work in India on the absenteeism of teachers from public schools.
And just to give you an indication, the Indian government tried every which way to stop us from doing this research. But I sort of barreled on and went ahead and did it. But, and what we did was we published that information and to the poor people. I mean, it was on billboards, it was on the radio and everywhere else. And all of a sudden, the Minister of Education began to realize that he could no longer continue to operate this way, especially there's a 25% absentee rates in was the average, and about 40% in some places. And eventually, the Prime Minister of India realized that this was a useful way to actually hold some of the chief ministers of states accountable. So we had this sort of color-charted map of absentee rates in different states, and that map is now on the Prime Minister's own website, even though they had actually tried to stop us from doing the research. So there are ways of getting at it, but it is really to change the incentives facing these politicians. That's the key.
Thank you, and I think Dr. Zubair wanted to come in on this point.
I think my focus and stress on the issue of creating a constituency or the confluence of stakeholders is probably being misunderstood. What I'm trying to emphasize here is the following. At the end of the day, reforms are good for everybody. How you sell it to the people matters. But you will have to, under these circumstances, step on a number of toes. It's easier for you to step on those toes if you have the popular support with you. The only way you can get that popular support is to be able to identify what good that program will do for you. I can cite you the examples of Poland. I can cite you the example of Turkey. I can cite you the example of Korea and of Chile, where it happened, it succeeded, and was done precisely with the intent of creating an infrastructure which allowed implementation of policies. Otherwise, we'll just plod along. In Egypt, too, they'll plod along. And the result will be in 5 years' time, you'll probably be in the same place as you are right now, while other countries will have gone far ahead of you. Do you want to do that? That's the fundamental point.
Thank you. Let's turn it over to the audience. I will start with the gentleman in the first row. There's a microphone. And as I said, please be brief so we can fit in a number of questions. Thank you.
Thank you. It's Dana Marshall with Transnational Strategy Group. I can't think of any more important economic and job growth creating infrastructure improvement than in the electric power sector. We've seen reports recently that even now in midwinter, there are brownouts in Egypt. God knows what will happen when we get into the air conditioning season. I wonder if the panel could speak a bit about the power sector reforms there and the role of the big Gulf contributing countries in enhancing creditworthiness there and in perhaps in providing fuel for power.
Thank you. And I'll ask the panelists to take notes of these questions later, decide which you want to answer. You won't be answering all, but we'll take five or six short questions. Let me turn to the right. The gentleman there, please stand up so the microphone can reach you. Thank you. And do introduce yourself. Thank you, Dana, for that.
My name is Jay Roddy, and I'm from the Tahrir Institute for Middle East Policy. I was wondering what the importance of security sector expenditures like the military, the intelligence agencies, and so forth, whether that's important to Egypt's budget situation and whether there's any chance for reform in those sectors.
Thank you. Gentleman here. Microphone here, please.
Thank you. I'm George Dragnich. I'm a former Assistant Director General of the International Labor Organization. I have not heard the word anytime tourism. I traveled to Cairo in April 2011 from Geneva with my counterpart from the World Tourism Organization to try to see what we could do as an economic driver and an employment generator. And it is a labor-intensive industry and always will be. And tourism receipts are down 90%. It's probably come up somewhat, but the recent murder of South Korean tourists in the Sinai will probably drive it back down again. We were always trying to get a handle, and this is what I'm asking, what percentage is it? If you take the back office, all of the subsidiary industries, and we're going all the way down to the fellaheen growing papyrus for the artist who will then sell it in the shops and so on, we're talking 25% or 30% of the economy. I don't know if it's actually that high. But it is a major driver of the economy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. From the back, the gentleman in the back, his arm is raised. Yes. Yes, you, sir.
Good morning. Thank you for the the opportunity. My name is Ibrahim Hussein. I'm a living Egyptian-American living in D.C. Your panel seemed to be pushing for building a constituency. I did not hear the word consensus or unity or pulling together. And unless we promote this, like the South African and many other countries, get our act together for the sake of Egypt, the idea that I win and you lose is ridiculous. What are the chances of reaching some kind of a consensus or a unity or for the sake of Egypt?
Thank you. The gentleman in the second row. Microphone, please. Hold on, we just need the microphone. Say that again. Thank you.
I'm a retired lead agriculturist from the World Bank. And I haven't heard agriculture per se or any of the technical sectors. I want to emphasize one thing is implementing agricultural reform is not new to the World Bank experience. I've participated in Indonesia, in China, in India, and in Turkey. In China, after Deng Xiaoping, we were selecting a province-by-province approach. But there was no emails at the time, there was no media, and things were learned quietly and taking its time. I'm not going to dwell on that, but implementing reform, you need to know the language of the people, of the farmers. In Egypt, if he quotes to you his yield in Ardab, you have to have a sense what is Ardab is. It is a volumetric measurement. So the people who go and discuss and try to get a handle on that should know the language, and that comes back to getting in touch with the what he calls the original stakeholders at the bottom. And agriculture, if you want to talk about unemployment, stems from there and goes back to there. If you want to talk about food for the people, whether you're going to have self-sufficiency in wheat, it's there.
Thank you. So the question is about the agricultural sector. Let's go to our panel. Let's go to our panel for the first round of answers. Ahmed, Tadda.
No, I'll focus mainly on the issue of constituency for reform, and maybe then go to the rest very fast. Buying in people is a little bit difficult in Egypt because the issue of exclusion is high. And any kind of a political leader who is coming is always afraid of further exclusion. In the sense of what? Now, the issue of fuel subsidies, theoretically, is easily that the 80-20 rule, where the 20% of the population are benefiting from 80% of the subsidies, whereas 80% is losing. Now, why it's difficult to reform it? The issue of cash transfers in Egypt is difficult because a lot of people are not registered. So in case you switch to cash transfers, then further another element, another layer of people who are benefiting from the kind subsidies will be further excluded. Adding to that, from a political economy perspective, you have the middle class. With the middle class is the one that's playing the active role in politics, but if you undertake any kind of reform, they will be hit hard. And if they are hit hard, those are the guys who have voice in the media. Those are the guys who can go to the streets. They are not the poor. So you have to buy those guys in as well. And you have to provide the incentives, as you rightly said. But what are the kind of incentives for them if the public transport is not good? Now, good news is that there are some new projects being undertaken to solve the issue of the traffic, like the Nile taxi. And I was surprised to know the price of the Nile taxi when somebody told me that it is £50 for a day, for a ride going and back, forth, which is terribly expensive. But then I thought, they are targeting a certain element of people, which is right. The other poor people will take the other poor stuff, but this is the right pricing of it. They're thinking of public buses with Wi-Fi. They are going to be soon there, and they'll be expensive, but this is the right thinking of how you provide alternatives. Coming to the issue of the Gulf and whether they are definitely providing fuel in terms of grants, and that was the latest Saudi was with $4 billion, including $2 billion. I think $1 billion of it, or the $2 billion in grants in terms of fuel subsidies. So they are helping in that sense. But whether this is the right thing or not, again, from a theoretical point of view, as Dr. Iqbal said, they are delaying reforms, but I'm not very sure that they're delaying reforms. They are the Gulf is providing the subsidies to protect themselves from the invasion of the Muslim Brotherhood, and in that sense, it can be sustainable in the short run till Egypt is standing on its. So I'm not worried. That's the only thing I'm not worried about, is that the Gulf support will continue at least for the coming few years, even at higher levels. Tourism is a big issue, as you rightly said, but with terrorism and political instability, you cannot have it as a main source of growth. The latest, the studies that I'm aware of, estimated it between 11 and 20% of GDP if you take the other related activities to it. But how can we solve it in that sense? That's the main issues that I can comment on.
Thank you. Thanks for these great questions. I'll try to answer just a few. On the power sector and in infrastructure, again, the problem is the reason for the brownouts are the subsidies. When you subsidize it, then you have a gap between supply and demand that's very hard to meet. So it's really the other side of the same coin. And it's misleading to say the problem with the power sector is we don't have enough investment in infrastructure. That investment in infrastructure will not be productive unless we can do something about the prices as well. On tourism, just one other footnote to what Ahmed said. It's also sometimes useful to look at what is the net foreign exchange earnings from tourism. Because tourists also demand a lot of imports, even down the chain. I mean, I've done this analysis for other countries, and it's about 25 cents on the dollar. So yeah, you know, we should be humble a little bit about
in terms of employment. What the
employment is actually, yeah, employment can be significant, but there are other ways to get there. Then on the gentleman, the living Egyptian American asked about consensus and unity, and I think it's absolutely right. I mean, and it can be done. And I would say, I mean, it may be still too early to tell, but I think Tunisia is heading that way. In Tunisia, the latest constitution really represented a consensus from parties that started out from very different starting points, and they came together. And so it is possible to do that, and I fully agree. Finally, on agriculture, the colleague of Ahmed's, Professor Adil, has written this fascinating paper on the history of agricultural policy in Egypt, and you realize that agriculture was also captured, just like everything else. So they would offer a subsidy, but then lower the buying price for the product, so that the farmer was no better off to begin with. So we really have to unblock. This capture of agriculture, and I fully agree with you, if we can do that, there's a lot of potential, particularly in Upper Egypt.
I just want to add a few things to it. First of all, this issue about the security sector and its role in the budget. Look, it's a nation's own decision to decide as to how much it wants to spend on security or any other activity as far as the budget is concerned. The challenge that you come to it is relative importance and significance for the economy and the society. In the case of Egypt, the security expenditure is a very fuzzy concept because quite a bit of that expenditure is outside the budget and is funded by funds which are directly under the control of the president or whosoever is in power. Quite a bit bit of that money has not been put back into the budget, and that's the reason why the budget deficit today looks less than what it should be. It should be about 16%, which looking like as if it's 13%, because quite a bit of that money that used to come from the president's own slush fund is not part of the budget. The point is, when you make a choice, the choice has to be based on the economic return. Economic return requires acceptance of what the people want. And that is why I keep saying constituency stakeholders are important. You can't do without that. Second, the issue of tourism. You see, for example, there have been two projects which have been implemented, funded by the GCC. One is about $4.5 billion, another one is coming in about $5 billion equivalent in the second half of the fiscal year. The success or the failure of those programs is very much conditional on what happens to the tourism sector and to the manufacturing sector. And the present view is the problems in the tourism sector because of security, uncertainty, whatever you want to call it, is such that it's not going to create any beneficial effects. Thank you.
Thank you. Steve, do you have any comment, particularly on the sectors that were mentioned?
Yeah, absolutely. Just a couple comments come to mind to follow up. On the power sector, of course, beyond the subsidy reform, we have been told that, you know, around 30 billion Egyptian pounds will be invested in infrastructure, and one of the areas they're talking about is upgrading the power plants. So that's something that we hope from a commercial point to see and see U.S. companies be able to be a part of that. And on tourism, certainly, you know, share, you know, the security concerns. But one thing for us, you know, in the commercial vantage point, it's imagery. And so when we go there and take our large delegation, we're certainly going to have kind of a tourism component to that. Obviously, you know, we'll do our standard meetings with the business sector and government officials, but you know, we want to take, you know, these 100 business leaders or however many are with us and go visit some of the sites. Again, a picture's worth a thousand words, as the adage goes. So you know, we'll look to do that. And because, you know, until you're out of the headlines and you know, kind of allay some of those concerns, you know, it's going to be a driving concern still. So we hope to have a role in that.
Thank you, Steve. Let's take another round of questions. Gentleman in the back, stand up, please, to get the microphone. Thank you.
Marwan Ayed. We often talk about the political outcome of excluding the Muslim Brotherhood and outlawing the organization. Obviously, their funds have been held as well. I'm wondering if there is an economic effect of their exclusion as well.
Thank you. First row, yes, gentleman right here. Microphone, just 1 second. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I'm Khalid Ikram. I used to be the World Bank's director in Egypt for 5 years. Two quick comments on forging a consensus for reform. The first is that the cabinet we've got and the cabinet...
Put the microphone closer to you.
The cabinet that we've got and the cabinet that we've had for the last few years, for the last 2 or 3 years, really don't represent a uniform point of view. They've been cobbled together with people with different ideological backgrounds and different agendas for the future. And so I think the first thing is to build a consensus among the cabinet itself. If you permit me one reminiscence, when I was negotiating one of these things with Abdulrazza Abdulmagid, when he was the deputy prime minister of Egypt in charge of the economy, and he had this whole agenda before him in the cabinet, he called me after the cabinet meeting and said, Khalid, it was the usual thing. Everyone wanted to go to heaven, but no one was prepared to die. I think that's pretty much
that's a dangerous metaphor, but yes, I'll
situation
take it.
Now. And Hamid Asaya put it differently, but he said, Khalid, the cabinet is not interested in reforms. It only wants the results of reforms. Mm-hmm. It wants the end without the means. And I think that that is true of almost every cabinet that you've got working here.
Okay. That's, the last, yeah.
Sorry.
Thank
that's,
you, please. Mm-hmm.
That was a destructive part of my comment.
Yes.
The constructive part.
Now the constructive part, yes.
Shanta, have you thought of reorganizing the consultative group? Because that way you get a much bigger pot of money on the table with coordinated policies. We started the first one in 1977 and had one in 1978, but I believe the last one was 2002. It's as far back as that. Because you build a consensus for unpopular reforms or for difficult reforms only when you tell them what kind of cushion you can provide them.
Thank you very much. Questions? A lady in that, please stand up to get the microphone. Thank you.
My name is Tatiana Sharif San Luis, and my question is more towards the corporates in Egypt, because we have a handful of very big, very successful corporations in Egypt operating. And when I just picked on the message that there now there is again a movement towards more investment, my question is maybe to all. Looking at Egypt's success throughout the 2004 till 2009 and having a strong economic growth with 7%, but basically the trigger down of, you know, like the success was very, not very successful, and we had an increase in poverty, and now, as you mentioned, one of your panels mentioned, we have now a 5% increase. My question would be more the role we see. Egypt has always had a tradition of consolidating power, where with a strong military established behind the economy as a driving force. Now, my question would be, if we were engaged politically, economically, in trying to push for reforms, wouldn't that be a risk at the bottom line for the military establishment that maybe owes up to 40% of the economy? So tackling issues like subsidies, tackling even bringing stakeholders from the corporates, you know, engagement with new investments, isn't it that we're going to be speaking again in terms of the same stakeholders, the same people around the same table? And my question here to the corporate, maybe to the to Mr. Lutes, what role, if at all, corporates in Egypt could have or possibly take in pushing for more an inclusive economy in Egypt in the next 3-4 years.
Thank you very much. The lady in the front and the gentleman in the back. Lady, please stand up to get the microphone. Thank you.
I'm Poonam Gupta. I work with Shanta in the World Bank on Egypt, Yemen, and Djibouti. I have a question for Mr. Ghoneim. And, you know, all this, Shanta knows from Africa, we have a very close-knit community of African researchers were also very active in dialoguing with the government. Now, maybe is that something that you can do to build consensus, is researchers teaming up with EXT media to build consensus?
Thank you. The gentleman in the back at the window.
Thank you so much. Actually, the situation in Egypt, my name is Dr. Ruiz. I'm with Taos University and engineering consultant, energy storage and deformation processing. Anyway, looking into the situation in the country right now, it's very confusing to me as an Egyptian living here for almost 30 years. The reason is, if you go back to the January 25th revolution, none of the two major powers acting in the country right now were there. The Muslim Brotherhood didn't show up unless a few days after that. So they cannot claim they were behind toppling Mubarak. Second, military. They kept themselves very calm. And even they were there. But look at what happened to the police force on the streets of the country. They've been withdrawn out. This means that something was going on to push this Morsi government down, and it happened. Now we see the military, they are coming back. In my humble opinion, we are discussing economics, that's great, but it's mainly political. The most of the Egyptian masses, they do not belong to neither of these two factions, in my humble opinion. They don't even show any care to them. And actually, what is going to happen in the country, it has to be solved politically first before we get into economics. Thank you so
much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Last two questions. Yes, Julie.
Julie Taylor, George Washington University. As a political scientist, I sort of see the problem a little bit differently. You have politicians who want to maintain power, and you have the military that would like to see greater stability in Egypt. I mean, that's the political reality that you're up against. And while you're presenting these plans for what's optimal for Egypt or the Egyptian people, do you ever present plans that are, this is something that's good for you and good for the Egyptian people, in which you're meeting some of their more immediate concerns? I was disappointed to hear that cash transfers would be a problem, but it seems like something like that, where you can say to them, here's something that you can offer to people that's going to maintain support that is tangible for them in the immediate term. It's good for you. It'll keep them off the streets. But then here's how you can implement those longer term plans.
Thank you. Last question. The gentleman with his hand up. Stand up, please, to get the microphone. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Tom Chiniak, and I'm here with Silatech. My question is, what can the government and private sector partners do to help alleviate youth unemployment without increasing the traditional reliance on public sector employment?
Thank you. Let's turn to our panel, and let's go in reverse order. So, Steve, you go first.
Well, I'll combine the question on the inclusive role with that very last question on youth unemployment, and say one thing that we're looking at, and it's something that we traditionally haven't done, is because typically speaking, we work with these large corporate members. But one thing that we're exploring, and we're talking to a variety of different people, is this entrepreneurism. And you know, there is a very hungry, dynamic youth doing a lot of interesting things. So we're talking to associations like the Young Entrepreneurs Associations, to Flat Six Labs, people who are doing very innovative things that are kind of outside the normal corporate silos, if you will. So, you know, we're hopeful that, you know, entrepreneurism and things like this can get at some of that youth unemployment, as well as bring new people to the table, you know, for the conversations that are being had. So it's not just, you know, those that have been at the table for many, many years. But those are some of the things that we're working on. But we do see entrepreneurism, and it's one thing that we're very excited about. In fact, right now some of my colleagues are at in Jordan at the Dead Sea, and we're having a kind of Middle East regional meeting, and there's a big breakout on entrepreneurism, and we know that the Egyptians are well represented at that. So it's something that we're certainly delving into and exploring.
Thank you, Steve. Dr. Iqbal?
Well, I think I was a bit intrigued by this question about what is politically feasible and what's economically feasible, and how can we do something politically feasible that will then open the door for economics reforms. The problem really is that there are basically conflicting objectives. If you do something which is politically feasible, it is most likely not economically feasible or desirable. So what you have to do is to make up your mind. That's what negotiation is all about. You have to decide, what do you give up for whatever you want? And that's the reason why it becomes so difficult to formulate a program and implement it. And believe it or not, formulating a program is very easy. It's implementation where the problem is. And the reason why the problem is that even those stakeholders who agree to the program move away from it once they realize the consequences of it. So what you have to do is to have a very tight leash on that. The way you have a tight leash on that is to make sure the people know it. You should be able to embarrass those who disagree with the program that has been agreed upon. So politics, yes, but you have to have a bit of a control over who does what.
Thank you, Zubair. Dr. Shanta?
Okay, let me first answer Khaled's question about the consultative group, because the fact is that there is a consultative group. It's called the Deauville Partnership. Some of you may have heard of it, but it's been a disaster. this might get recorded too, but I've actually said it in public before. No, I mean, because the members got together and pledged, I think, $40 billion or something at some point, and almost nothing has emerged from it. And it's partly because it was driven by the Europeans, who then pleaded poverty because they were having their own fiscal problems. And the Gulf members basically said, okay, well, we're going to do it on our own. So this is a very difficult time to reproduce what you did with the consultative group, particularly given the experience with Deauville. Now, I just want to come back to this question the lady who's a political scientist was asking, and maybe this is a comment on something that Ahmed said as well. I don't believe that cash transfers are a problem. It's true, they haven't had the full registry, but if we can do that in a country like India or Bangladesh,
for that matter, which has got, I don't know, what, 25% of the per capita income of Egypt, we should be able to do it in Egypt. You have the capacity, you've got the technology, and today with the technology with the smart cards, you can do it very cheaply as well. So that's not the excuse. That's an excuse. That's not the reason. The reason is, of course, that the people who tell you well, we can't do cash transfers are actually the ones who are threatened by the reforms. And finally, I like this question about what can the government do for the youth employment. And I think it's what Steve said as well, because it really comes back to the question that, you know, what is the youth employment problem? I think the government can do a lot to promote the informal sector, which is where most of the youth are. Just remember, and this entrepreneurship is really, it's not formal versus informal. It is everybody. You can relax the restrictions to start a business help the entrepreneurs. I mean, Egypt has a lot of small and medium enterprises. And there's a view that, well, we should help small and medium enterprises because that's where most of the people are employed. The problem is most of those are old small and medium enterprises. They were small and medium 10 years ago. They're not the ones that are going to generate growth. The young firms are the ones that are the dynamic ones. And we need to identify those and promote them rather than promoting all the SMEs in the country. And then one final point on that. We talk about the informal sector. But there's another dimension to that, which is that women's participation in the informal sector is actually quite low. And we've done surveys where, you know, the women say they actually find it threatening to work in the informal sector. So women's employment is women, in the case of women, it's not just unemployment, it's the fact that they drop out of the labor force. It's the labor force participation that's the problem. So you got to also think about it from that side, that just setting up entrepreneurship without some protection for women so that they don't have to feel threatened in the informal sector has to be part of the solution.
Thank you, Ahmed.
Yeah. Interesting questions. Let me start by saying that we have Khaled Ikram here, who has written a book about Egypt, and I had the pleasure to review it, and it's an excellent book. It combines politics, history, and economics, so he knows everything about Egypt. Now, what we've seen in Egypt is that there is a high turnover of cabinets. We even surpassed Jordan, which is number one in terms of. So this doesn't give any incentive for anybody in office to do any kind of reform, because he knows that he will be overthrown in less than 3 or 4 months, and he wants to live his life normal afterwards. And we have the two examples of this, a guy who acted as a minister of finance and who was so generous, and he expanded everything, including with the one signature, the hiring of 500,000 people in government. And he was liked by people, and he did a disaster. And then we have another guy who resisted all this, and he was thrown out as well. So whether you're a good guy or a bad guy, you're thrown out. So why the hell should I do anything? And that's preference of the status quo, and that's what's happening all the time right now in Egypt. Let me have the title of an ex-minister and live my life with this title. That's the main issue. With all this, I believe that whoever comes in power, and that was one of the issues that Paul asked for me to address in the panel, and it is related to the issue, must have an economic and a political, some kind of a major, mega project. And I do believe, whether it is Sisi or not Sisi, the economic program will be related to the Suez Canal corridor. And this project is definitely the future of Egypt. And it will buy in a lot of investors, it will get in a lot of employment, and if it is done right. So this is the issue. The other political is to build the constituency. And despite, as rightly said by Dr. Oweis and Shantay and Dr. Iqbal as well, buying constituency will happen once there is a new president who one of the main issues will bring all the people together. But I do not see that the economics can work before getting, as he rightly said, the politics right and having this constituency. Two things regarding how researchers interact. I did the research about that before, and in Egypt, this is not a problem. They interact all the time, not necessarily in formal forums, but informally, either by having the researchers themselves as ministers or having them as deputy or advisors to the ministers, or by just picking up the phone and calling the guys. And this happened a lot to me, that the interaction is there all the time. So you don't have to worry about it. But the political reality and the role of the decision making is out of the hands of the ministers and the researchers. The final thing is about the SMEs, and that's what Shantay said. And I believe that's the future of Egypt, but we deal with it as the elephant in the room. We deal with SMEs, not only the old SMEs, but we deal with it as one entity. Whereas SMEs needs and prospects differs tremendously, not even in the one sector, but in the subsector itself. So it's not a matter of finding finance for them. It might be a matter of getting in the loop of the value chain or the subcontraction. And unless we resolve the issues in a more micro detailed analysis, then it will remain the elephant in the room. Thank you.
Thank you, Ahmed. Thank you for this really excellent panel on a very critical and timely subject. Please visit MEI website. Dr. Iqbal's paper is there. There's a number of other papers and interviews on Egyptian economy which will be going up in the next few days. And become a member of MEI if you can afford it as well. That would be great. Please join me in thanking this really excellent panel.